obstacles can come from some very odd ideas. Most of the time, this does not guarantee that the show will be any good. Witness the recently Tony-nominated Rocky the Musical, still shaking my head over that one, or the disaster that was Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark. Sometimes these ideas succeed and become classics of the genre, like Cats, which is basically a book of poems about cats at the music, or Godspell, which turns Jesus into a hippie, or a little show that turns the myth of the Declaration of Independence on its head, and then throws in some musical numbers just for the fun of it. Grab your fife and drum corps as we take a look at 1776. It's the summer of 1776, and the 13 colonies of America are in open rebellion against the King of England. Meanwhile, the colony's governing body, the Continental Congress, is busy dodging the question of independence. But John Adams of Massachusetts ain't having any of that. And along with the wise and witty Benjamin Franklin and the eloquent but distracted Thomas Jefferson, Adams will cajole, harangue, threaten, and outright push the Continental Congress into declaring independence. Of course, force of will alone won't stop the opposition, or the British Army. Politics is kind of hard to avoid in a movie like this, and this movie does have a definite slant, inasmuch as not much has changed concerning political wrangling in the past 200-some-odd years. On the other hand, the political wrangling and debating are the best parts of the movie. Oddly enough, the debating doesn't have much music to go along with it, with a few notable exceptions that I'll get to in a minute. First of all, let me talk about the direction and the setting. Outside of a few scenes, nearly all of the action takes place in the room in Independence Hall where the Continental Congress met. Now, this presents a bit of a challenge in terms of how to keep the audience's interest for 2.5 hours. On stage, this isn't much of a problem, but with film, you can't pull a C-SPAN and just show a guy yammering away behind a lectern. In this case, the director, Peter H. Hunt, chooses to keep the characters moving as much as possible and the camera moving with them, so there's a lot of long single shots following the characters as they debate the future of America. This keeps everything moving and the audience engaged. But unless you find history as endlessly fascinating as I do, you might get a little bored. This will probably get exacerbated by the 40-minute long song drought that comes in during the first debating portion of the movie. It's not a deal-breaker by any means, but it is something to keep in mind. On the good side, the writing for this movie just crackles with energy and wit. It's not quite Aaron Sorkin levels of fast pace, but it does move at a pretty good clip. Now then, acting. Top-notch all around. It's worth noting that even the background characters get a decent amount of characterization. The members of the Continental Congress aren't there just as window dressing for the dramatic tension between Adams and company in the opposition. Minor characters like Richard Henry Lee, John Hancock, Caesar Rodney, and Charles Thompson are all deftly written and well acted. William Daniels, who most viewers will remember as Mr. Feeney from Boy Meets World, gives John Adams a fierce energy and pride that makes him so much more than a name in a history book. Howard De Silva does very well as Ben Franklin, giving him wit and vibrance as well as wisdom and political acumen. As for the opposition, Donald Madden is excellent as Adams' semi-loyalist foil, John Dickinson, and John Cullum delivers a powerhouse of a performance as Edward Rutledge of South Carolina. The music fits the tone and feel of the movie pretty well for the most part. Standouts in the score include The Lees of Virginia, Cool, Considerate Men, and Is Anybody There? John Cullum gets what may be the best song in the whole movie, the powerful if disturbing Molasses to Rum. Cullum just knocks this song out of the park and never looks back. Now, it's worth pointing out that there are two female characters in this movie. Unfortunately, most of the problems that the movie has stem from their scenes. There are two distinct subplots concerning the ladies in this movie. On the one hand, you have the relationship between Adams and his wife Abigail. Not bad on the whole, but this subplot makes the movie drag a little, although they do have a pretty fun duet at the beginning.
Pins, madam. Saltpeter.
Pins.
Saltpeter.
Pins.
Saltpeter.
Pins.
Saltpeter.
Pins.
Peter.
Pins.
Peter.
Pins.
Peter.
Pins.
Peter.
Pins.
Next, there's Martha Jefferson. Her subplot is resolved quickly within two scenes. This is a plot that feels a bit tacked on. They explain her presence well enough, but her scenes are really just there to break up the two debate portions of the film. Her one song, He Plays a Violin, is fun, but there's no real reason for it to be there. The last point I want to bring up is the song Mama Looks Sharp. It's sung by the messenger who makes a few appearances throughout the movie to deliver George Washington's letters to Congress. Sadly, it's not a particularly good song, in my opinion. I know what they were trying to go for with the song, showing you a soldier's point of view about the war and its consequences, but the song and the way it's staged for the movie is boring, and I usually end up skipping over it. If you're a diehard American history buff or a political wonk of any stripe, you'll find something to like about this movie. While there are portions that drag a little, the acting and the catchy songs do make up for it. If you decide to get this one, the director's cut is the easiest to find, and by all means, listen to the commentary track by director Peter Hunt and screenwriter Peter Stone. Hunt and Stone both worked on the original Broadway production and talk a lot about the transition from stage to screen, including some of the editing shenanigans that went on before the movie premiered. I really recommend this movie to musical fans and history buffs. The acting is excellent, the songs are fun and catchy, and the writing is smart and funny. This is a good movie to watch on the 4th of July between the hot dogs and fireworks. It's fun, and you might even learn a thing or two. Maybe. Either way, it's definitely worth checking out.